All right, good afternoon, everybody. So before we go into the Jekyll or the Hyde of security, let me introduce myself. My name is Tsvi. This is how you spell it. And I've been doing security for a little while, about 15 to 20 years. And I've been doing containers for about 2 years now. So one of the first things that I asked when dealing with this new thing of containers is really, what is a container? What are the implications of container? What are the security implications of container? So let's try to answer that question first. A container is a methodology to deploy applications. A lot of people say that it's similar to VMs. There are slight similarities to VM, but they are not as much as you might think. They are a way to make process run on a host, but keep it, think like it's private, so that we can run multiple instances of sometimes conflicting pieces of software on the same host. And that's one of the biggest advantages of containers, and that is why there's such a hot trend in the industry. And they are a hot trend in the industry. We've seen the number of servers that run any type of containers actually jump throughout the last year or two. And the question of why would you care, and actually I prepared to do this in front of like three people that didn't care, but there are a lot of people that do care, so you really don't need that slide. But in your organizations, in your respective organizations, there is going to be containers, either today, somewhere, or tomorrow, or next week, definitely by the end of the year, and probably a lot by the end of the year. So let's kind of try to demystify a little bit what containers are. Containers really start their life as archives. Archives where developers put together bits of an operating system. So in Linux, it could be a slash bin directory, it could be a slash etc directory, maybe even with a password file in it. All the prerequisite software that containers need. So if you want to run a Java application, there will be Java in there. There will be the application server, maybe Apache, maybe Nginx if you want to run something like that. And then there is going to be the application, the actual thing the developers write that is particular to the organization. All these things goes into an archive and becomes basically a tar file. There are some layers and ways to manage them a little bit more efficiently, but basically it's a tar file. Those files then get housed in a registry. So they will be stacked together with a naming convention that has a repository on the one end, a colon, and then the tag on the other end. And they are just waiting there, basically stacks of archives in a registry or maybe as tar files that are just waiting to be run. When they are running, those archives are going to be transferred to a host running a container engine, which is nowadays synonymous with Docker. So Docker container engine, no offense to Rocket and others, but basically a container engine. And then something very interesting is going to happen. That image is going to be opened up, and the file system of that image is going to be copied into a temporary archive, a temporary storage on that host. The process tree that is going to be managed by the container engine actually runs natively on the operating system. So a container engine is going to take a look at that image. That image has all the files in it, and it also has some metadata, a manifest that tells what program needs to be run, and of course there's a way to override that program. But in any case, the container engine is just going to run that process. Now, the process and why containers are not like VMs is actually running natively on the operating system. So there's no hypervisor layer, there's no isolation, there's no dedicated slices of the processor. What there is a segmentation of the file system. So the root of the container is going to be mapped to the root of whatever the temporary storage that containers are opened up at. It's going to be isolated by namespaces and C groups. So these are well-known Linux techniques that provide for the isolation of resources. But in the end of the day, they share memory space. They share kernel space. And they even share user space. So one of the things that we need to remember about containers when we want to run them is that as they run in the environment, it doesn't require the boot of an operating system because there's no hypervisor. We don't need a separate operating system. They just run as a process. And that they contain everything in them. That makes them awesome for DevOps. Because think about it. You create something once. You then get a processor up in a second or two. You can get many of them run on the same hardware because they're not going to collide with one another because there is some isolation on the file system. And they can run anywhere because all the prerequisites are there. So if I manufacture an image and that image has my web stack in it, and I want to run it one day on-premise on my Ubuntu Linux, and the other day at Amazon on their Amazon for ECS, and another time on Azure on CentOS. As long as the kernel matches, and most of the time the kernel matches because that is a prerequisite of Docker, they're going to run. So the benefits for DevOps and the ability to get rid of the finger pointing, get rid of the testing cycle, get rid of the prerequisite game, it makes them really, really loved by DevOps. Security professionals, probably not so much. and apart from the confusion that happens, there are really interesting concerns around what containers do. So first of all, this whole concept of a prepackaged image. So I take everything that I need, the operating system, the prerequisite components, the payload of the application, basically put it together in a tarball and then run it. So one of the people that I met throughout my journey with container security actually described it as, you're asking me to pick a USB key off the floor, stick it in a server, and run the first program that USB key has on it. Or to some people that are more my age, take a CD-ROM off the floor, put it in a server, and run, you know, and do the auto run. So that is a problem because there is not a lot of transparency in the container system. Not a security concern per, you know, something bad is going to happen, but an uneasiness that makes security organization be suspicious of containers. Another thing that happens is that the image needs to run as is, right? So when the image gets instantiated into a container, the file system of the image is then being used as is by the process that the container engine runs. You can't modify it. And skip to like the second from last bullet, you also can't patch it in place. But before we get into that, all this, the things that go into a container, because who are the ones that building them? They're developers, so they're heavily influenced by developers. So listen to this, we need to trust developers to put stuff we don't know into a format we're not familiar with and then having to run it on a server. What can go wrong with that? Add to that containers are invisible to most security tools. So if you run, let's say, a Nessus scan on a host, it's going to tell you that, you know, there are some processes on them and there's Docker on them and there's a file system on it, but they won't be able to put it together. They won't tell you that these processes belong to this image, these processes belong to this container because they're not container aware. Everything happened fast, right? We release several times a day, DevOps. Everything is agile. So you have those opaque images that you don't know what's in them, that you are requested to run in a server, that you can't monitor, that you can't look into, and you can't even fix them if they're broken. And by the way, all the networking also happens inside of the host. We have no visibility into that. So a problem. And the gut reaction of us as security professionals is basically to say no. You know, you can't run containers. So I hope that I'll be able to change your mind. But before I do that, let me scare you a little bit even more. So this is a video. I'm going to narrate it as it goes. Hopefully, I can actually start it. All right. So what happens here is that we are running Ubuntu. So this is going to be my Ubuntu prompt. I'm going to be running ID. So this is my user. If you look right at the end here, I'm a member of the Docker group, which is a prerequisite to do anything with Docker. And as a non-privileged user, I'm going to try to touch my password file, which, of course, I should not be able to. Now, let's run a container. If you haven't seen a container run, it's like magic. So I'm doing Docker run, -it interactive or with terminal. I want to RM, remove it when it's done. I want to use the user of the container as root. And I also want to mount some files from the host. So I'm doing mount slash from the host is going to be slash host on the container. And now I run it. Now the container runs, download it from the Docker hub. And this is a CentOS image running inside of an Ubuntu image. And I just downloaded, and now I'm inside of the container. So what can I do inside of the container? Well, I can, first of all, figure out that I'm root inside of the container, which is kind of freaky. And then I'm going to cat two files. I'm going to cat the password file inside of the container, because remember, containers have etc in them. So that's a password file inside of the container. And then I'm going to cat the slash host slash etc password file, which is actually coming from the underlying host. Now remember, the user context is UID0. It's UID0 both on the container and the host. So if I do a touch on my password file, or even worse, I'm able to do that, right? So, and then I exit, and then the container is gone. So that duality of what's running inside of a container, what's running outside of a container, what's something that is in the user context of the container, what's in the user context of the host is a really big problem. Now, if I wasn't blinded by the projectors, I would probably see people that are really uneasy because this has been solved. This particular backdoor has been solved like a year ago. So Docker actually has a better use of namespaces from Docker 1.10 that actually does not make a user on a container be the user on the host. But you didn't know that. And the default of Docker is actually not to implement that. So one of the things that we as security professionals need to understand is that the platform itself has some security implications, and we have some security controls that we can make available so that the platform is more secure. On the other hand, we need to learn that. It's a new methodology. It's a new thing. We need to be aware of those things, and we need to ask the right questions so that when ops starts to deploy a containerized environment, one of the things that you really need to ask them is, what do you do about namespaces, and what do you do about user namespaces? So now you know how to ask the question. So please do that if you encounter a containerized environment. So other things that can go wrong. Vulnerabilities in the containers are prevalent because of the open source nature of them, and because a lot of times they are built on images that are downloaded from the Docker Hub. There are unauthorized images, so how do you know that what you're running, that thing that you're supposed to pick up the flow, is actually something that comes from your environment or from somewhere else? There are insecure configurations, i.e. Docker namespaces. There are privilege escalations, i.e. lack of Docker namespaces. Host resources impact, because again, you're sharing memory space, you're sharing CPU space, you're sharing resources with the host, so if you don't limit the number of threads or the number of processes, you can do an overrun on that. If you take a lot of CPU and you don't control for that, you're going to slow down the rest of the host. And then there are the more traditional threats that you know, because containers are still an application, we still need to be aware of them, and you know, we still need to have the WAFs around them, and we need to understand what the security posture of the application is. But because of containers being next to one another on hosts that are inside the network, a lot of times the level of impact or the radius of impact is a lot larger if something goes wrong, if somebody gains unprivileged access or unauthorized privileged access to a container. And then there's complete lack of accountability. So what I did earlier with that running of the Docker image and all that is not logged anywhere, because Docker does not have logging. The base operating system may or may not have logging on the processes that you started. There's no visibility, and you can see that I can obliterate a container just by making it exit. So it leaves no trace, right? So the risk arrears, they are the stuff of nightmares. But for every nightmare, there's a dawn. And now let's flip a page. Let's talk about how we can actually co-opt the very, very strange behaviors of containers into our purposes and just make the world a better place. So I'm going to talk about basically three things. There are a lot more other things, but these are the ones that I chose because I'm the expert. And those are going to be the ones that I would like to leave you with. So I'm going to leave a lot of room for questions, by the way. So the new opportunity. So things that we need to co-opt from the container world. So shift left, if you know what that means. It means that in the DevOps world, a lot of the decisions are being made closer to development. So if I'm that side. So closer to the development side and less towards the rollout side. The rollout side really should not be where you make security decisions. It's a lot of times too late. The other thing is that containers, unless they're in a demo, run with a lot of automations around them. Containers are built for automations. Containers are built to be managed by other things. There are things like Kubernetes, Swarm, even Chef and Puppet and Ansible can be used to run containers. But usually it's the newer stuff. It's the Mesosphere of the world. It's Amazon ECS. It's Azure Container Services. It's Google Container Services that are going to run the automation of those containers en masse. Automation is good, and we'll see how we can co-opt that to our needs. And then the last thing is that we can do a lot of prevention with containers because they are moving to microservices. So containers are really not built to be big behemoth applications. They are built to be small microservices, and we can do some prevention. So let's dive right in into the first one. So shift left. Shift left, as you can see, that you know we used to have secure on the side, which is kind of fading away, and now we need to move secure forward. So let me talk about one real quick aspect of that. Patching, or patching of the base operating system. So old world of application, monolithic application, developers develop. As they develop, there's a lot of work being done on the infrastructure side. So we develop a host. We deploy a host, either from a VM image, and then we do all the patching on it. And basically, we harden the host if it's a critical application, and we make it such that the application will run securely on it. So as you've seen in the little video of the demo is that, unfortunately, if we do that and then deploy an image from another operating system or an image that doesn't have those patches, the actual processes that run are the processes from the image. So we need to bring back those practices of how to deploy a secure host, how to harden it, how to make sure that the settings are correct, that the packages are up to date, but do it right at the beginning. So containers are built on base images. Basically, you layer operating system components one over the other, as you've seen in the build slide. And we might want to make sure that the base images are secure. If you go to your organizations right now, ask the question, where do you get your base images? And the answer is going to be a very sheepish, the Docker Hub, which is the wrong answer. So what we want to have is you and us and the people that know how to build servers be participant in that process. So make sure that you have a base image practice that will be able to provide the development side with the right infrastructure on which to build their containers. Now, once we have those containers in place, we need to differentiate between things that we had impact on and things that we did not have impact on. So register images as approved for use, or basically deny unapproved images. And there are ways to do that. We can make sure that images are signed. We can make sure that there are registries that are only networked by network segmentation are only available to our production environment. So it doesn't have to be a free-for-all. The last thing, or the last two things that we need to do is to deal with the fact that there are open source components in containers. And that means that there are bound to be vulnerabilities on them. There are bound to be some discrepancy in the packages or inconsistencies in the packages. So we want to make sure that we, after the finished product is done, that we have good vulnerability assessment on it. And beyond vulnerability assessment, things like, is the image requesting to run as UID 0? What are the packages? What are the minimum versions of those packages? Am I allowed to build an image with JDK 5? Hopefully not. So all these things have to be accounted for, have to be reported, and then give that feedback to developers so they can fix it. The only way that you really can do that effectively is to be in that process. You cannot do all that if you sit all the way up to the right, waiting for an application to be deployed in production, then run a vulnerability scan on it, and then force somebody to fix it, because they can't. Those images are baked in, those containers are already instantiated, and we have to do this in the beginning. So shift left is one of the strategies that the entire agile development is using, and security needs to co-opt that. We need to be part of that. We need to have the right conversations in order to do that. Now, let's assume that our images are good. How are they being deployed? Well, they're being deployed with a lot of automation. So that image that I just deployed is going to go into a pipeline, and that pipeline is going to then replicate it across n thousands number of hosts with the right orchestration in place. And that image is then going to run on a massive scale because we want containers that can both be agile and that they can be flexible enough so that if we need more capacity, we can add them horizontally. Automation brings something that is interesting because what it does, it takes a lot of times the human factor out of the equation. It can help you do a lot of the things that are not derived from an ad hoc operation, but by planning. So all the things that you see on the slide, including the use of files, the use of volumes, what resources containers use, the networking, the image integrity itself, all of those can be determined up front. And because we take the human factor out of it, we can then control the behavior of how applications are being rolled out, and we can have a lot less moving part, which means a lot less complexity, which means a lot less risk, because complexity is correlated with risk. I learned that this morning. So least privileges is good because it provides us with a lot of decisions up front. Those decisions up front needs to be the right decisions, right? So again, how do we play in that game? We ask the upside, how do they deploy containers? Under what user context do you deploy containers? Do they even care what the user context is? I mean, I care what the user context is. You should care what the user context is. But I'm not sure that ops really cares because they have other things to worry about, like availability and memory consumption and so on. So ask the right questions of how you deploy applications, and then can we map into that process? Now remember patching from like four slides ago. This is exactly how patching should be done in the container world. Because think about it. I have 5,000 containers running on 500 hosts, and suddenly the next shell shock comes into the world, or dirty cow, or whatever vulnerability du jour. So now I have a choice. How do I patch or even assess the level of risk in the entire environment? You could go, if you're at the very end of the process, into each one of those hosts and query that container and kind of understand what it does and so on. But why would you want to do that? That container is based on an image. That container is immutable. It hasn't changed, or at least not supposed to change, from the time that the image was produced. So let's use that automation. Let's use those tools the DevOps is using anyway. Go back to development, ask them to patch whatever files need to be patched, and with the literal click of a button, all these new images with that vulnerability fix can be rolled out en masse, slowly and safely replacing your code base, so that that vulnerability within hours can be eradicated from your systems. So it's that kind of thing that if we make sure that the containers are well built and that they are deployed in a way that makes sense to us, and that if we are part of the process, then we have a much better way to succeed and actually have better security. And speaking of better security, the last part is really the most novel part. And this is where it hits me, you know, about a year ago, that containers are not even a threat, they are an opportunity. We should all be enthusiastic and pushing for containers to be rolled out in the organization. And that is because when we roll out containers, for the most part, we are dealing with microservices. Microservices are micro, they are small. So if we take something like JBoss, we've done the analysis. So JBoss is running from an image. That image can have a lot of stuff in it, but what JBoss really needs, and that's with the bootstrap. We could probably minimize it to like five executables. These are the executables that JBoss needs. It needs one UID, and it needs one volume. So think about it. If we could do that on a server, right? If you could tell the server, hey, you are a server, you need to do one thing. Let's just make you do the thing that you want to do. Unfortunately, in the server world, it's much more complicated because other stuff will run in a server. Sometimes a user needs to log in. There are cron jobs. Don't even get me started even on Windows. So all these processes will run on a host that make it really complex and really impossible to manage the minimal level of access that's needed. Containers are different. Containers are meant to do one thing. They're meant to do it with one user context, and they're meant to do it with a very limited number of resources. So what if we could enumerate exactly what the container needs, and then on the right-hand side of the box, you start preventing, right? Even if I do Docker exec, so people who know Docker, this is a way to actually execute a command inside of a running container. Why would I need ping, right? That's the first thing that an attacker that gains the proverbial arbitrary command is going to try and do. It's going to try to do a ping sweep in the environment. It's going to maybe try copy files. It's going to maybe try install a package. Maybe it tries to do ls and see what a container is doing. So all of these things that are potential attack vectors can actually be denied because they're never going to use. Now, you can't do that with a server, because that is going to be impossible to manage, because you do need LS and you do need CP and you do need to do the patching on a server, so you do need YUM. But containers are different. Containers don't need that. So prevention is possible. Least privilege is possible. The ability to do that requires one thing and one thing only in an organization. yeah, there's software out there. Next year in RSA, there's going to be like a bazillion software companies that do container security. Aqua is one of them, sorry. But communication. Not who has the bigger megaphone, but how do we actually talk to one another? And when I say one another, I mean security, dev, and ops. If there was anything that is applicable to DevSecOps, it's running applications in containers. So let me tell you a story. I was back in September. I was in Australia, and I did a bunch of meetings in Melbourne, and I met with two companies at the same day on two other parts of town. I'm not going to say the company names, but just the imagine the scenery, right? On one of the companies, I met with two security people, report to the CISO, and they basically told us, we know we run containers, nobody's talking to us, we don't know what's going on, we're afraid that all these applications are being rolled out, there is no communication, I can't tell them what to do because the business needs to run and containers are efficient in running the business, so we just, help us, we just can't deal with the fact that people are running containers and we lose the visibility and security. So, you know, I sat there in a meeting and I was like, look, I'm really sorry, but I can't help you. Even if you run a piece of container security software, it's still not going to solve the fundamental problem that you're really not in the process, right? A few hours later, we actually went to the other side of Melbourne, and instead of two really, really frustrated security people, we had 11 people in the room. We had all the constituencies. We had security. We had dev. We had ops, we had product managers, we had the application owners, all sitting around the table and basically saying, look, this is something that we need to talk about. How do we do this? How do we merge the best practices from security? How do we merge the best practices from DevOps? And how do we make it happen? So these are extreme cases of the types of conversations that you will see in environments that run containers. A lot of times it's somewhere in between. A lot of times it's DevOps really wants to be part of the security process. They know that even if they start an application, at one point, especially if it's an in-scope application for name your regulation, they're going to have to do something about it. So we engage a lot with DevOps organizations that really want to do the right thing. And then the other side, there are security organizations that need to learn and need to educate themselves and need to understand what containers are. And very, very important, they need not to say no. So do not say no. And the reason is because you are going to get steamrolled by the proverbial container ship. I'm mixing metaphors intentionally here. And that's because organizations will do that. They will run containers. There are reputable companies out there that have containers running with mission-critical applications where we're just now getting around to security, like 6 months later. One of them I'm going to have to take my money out of. But that is the situation that we're dealing with. So your call to action, what you need to do in the next week, 3 weeks, whatever they wanted me to do in this slide. So find out where containers are running. They are there. A lot of times they may be in a pocket somewhere. They may be in development. They may have very limited use, maybe used for staging or testing or testing of staging. And they're going to be there. Now, the problem is containers are sneaky because everybody likes them. So before you know it, they are going to find a way into some kind of project and be a real mission-critical app. So in any place that you find them, either in the very, very beginning or as a deployed application, do not freak out. It's OK. Nothing bad's going to happen. Nothing bad has happened, right? Containers are not an automatic hack into your environment. But we need to start educating ourselves. So what do we need to do? We need to understand the business imperative. Why are people using containers? If that is to save a lot of money, then you can, you know, scream from the rooftops and you know, do a rain dance. It's still not going to help you, right? Because the organization is going to save a lot of money. So understand the business imperative. If it's just somebody's playing around, then you know, make sure it's in a sandbox, make sure that it's segmented from the networks, help them do it maybe in a segmented cloud environment. You know, don't just say no, but understand what the business imperative, understand why people are doing what they're doing. Support the effort. Once you understand why they're doing, say, how can I help? Repeat after me. How can I help you run in containers? No, I'm not going to make you do that. But just say that. How can I help? Develop your image policy, develop some internal ways to control the inflow of images. This is the number one place right now when vulnerabilities are going into an organization. So this is one way where you can actually have a positive impact and actually stop stuff. You're going to say, look, our standard is this server, right? Our standard is this server build. We are using Red Hat. We are using Debian. We are using a build of Linux that is hardened to our specifications. So be part of the process. Let me help you by providing you an image that is more aligned with our standards so you can stop developing on Ubuntu from the internet. Get visibility into the CI cycle. How the automation works is going to be very, very important, because this is where you can put some policy in place which will actually stop an image from going further into the cycle if it has egregious security problems. And then the last thing is that we really shouldn't forget who we are. We are security people. We have our processes. We know what we're doing. We've done this for a very, very long time. We just need to do it in a new way. We just need to do it in a way that is consistent with this new methodology of deployment. We need to do it in a way that maybe moves us from the end of the process to the beginning of the process. But don't be afraid to demand what you need to demand, which is if there is visibility, if there is compliance, if there is the need to have minimum standards of the components in place, if there needs to be an application penetration testing, even on containers, if the container environment, even if it's in the cloud, needs a web application firewall, or actually an actual firewall, you have the right to demand that, because these are things that pertain to the security of the application, as long as you do it from a positive attitude. So that is my soapbox. These are containers, and I'll open it up for questions. Thank you very much. Any questions? Did I do such a good job?
So you talked about containers and specifically referenced them as more of a lightweight solution or as a more kind of lightweight option. However, if you Google around a little bit, it's not too hard to come across these people talking about containers as replacements for VMs. What are your thoughts there, I guess, as a general?
So containers could be replacements for VMs, probably not as good as VMs, because VMs are good, right? They do something. So if you have a monolithic application forklifting it, as it's called, into a container, it's probably not going to do you a lot of good. So I think one of the worst thing that happens is that somebody equated containers with VMs, and they're not. There's no isolation, there's no hypervisor. Just because there's an image and we're used to VM images, it kind of got messed up a little bit. So the question is really about application re-architecture. What is the move to containers going to give you? What is the move to microservices going to give you? You can go microservices crazy and get network latency issues, but the idea is that everything needs to have a valid business reason. And just because containers are new and they're like VMs is probably not a good enough reason to forklift an application. All right, going once, going twice. Have a great rest of the day.